Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. Ashhadu an la أشهد أن محمد رسول الله. أشهد أن محمد رسول الله. حي على الصلاة. حي على الصلاة. حي على الفلاح. حي على الفلاح. الله أكبر، الله أكبر. لا
إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كلام الله، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. يقول ربنا عز وجل: بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. ألف لام ميم. أحسب الناس أن يتركوا أن يقولوا آمنا، أن يقولوا آمنا وهم لا يفتنون. ولقد فتنا الذين من قبلهم فليعلمن الله الذين صدقوا وليعلمن الكاذبين. الله سبحانه وتعالى سجن سورة العنكبوت ألف لام ميم. Do people think that they will say we believe and they will be left without a child? Verily, indeed, we have tried those before them, so that Allah subhanahu wa'ala finds out those who were truthful and those who were not truthful. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also says, وَنَبْلُوكُمْ بِالشَّدِّ وَالْخَيْرِ فِتْنَةِ. We will test you with ease and with hardship, with good and with bad, as a trial. And Allah also subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Surah Al-Mulk, الذي خلق الموت والحياة ليبلوكم أيكم أحسن عملا. It is He, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that created life and death, so that he finds out which of you is the best in deeds. Now from those ayahs, you gather that the topic today, inshallah, will be about the trials and the tests that we face in this dunya. These trials are not specific to Muslims or to non-Muslims. Most of these trials, as well as the Muslims, they happen to non-Muslims. But there are also some who are specific just to Muslims. Amongst the trials, you'll find ones that are hard, and some are easy. Some we pay attention to, some we don't pay attention to. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, from His justice, He made these trials and He gave us examples of these trials in the Quran, in His book. The prophets have been tried. The awliya have been tried. The non-Muslims have been tried. The Muslims have been tried. Before the time of Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, people have been tried. After the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, people have been tried. Some of the trials, they don't appear to us as trials, but they are. When given wealth, you think this is just a ni'mah. It could be a ni'mah, but at the same time, it is a trial. Sulaiman alayhi salam was given wealth, and when he saw the throne of the queen of Saba in front of him, he said, "Hada min fadli Rabbi, yabluwani ashkuru am akfur." This is a blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said, so that he tests me and he finds out whether I'm going to be grateful or I'm going to disbelieve and turn away. Others failed this same test. Qarun was given so much wealth, but what did he say? He said, "Innama utituhu ala ilm." I was given this wealth because of my knowledge, because I'm smart. What did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? فَخَسَفْنَا بِهِ وَبِدَارِهِ الْأَرْضِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made the earth swallow him and his wealth. Some of the trials are hard, as I said. But the hardest of them are those that are in the deen. Because the ones, for example, that are on the health or on the wealth, they take a certain time and they're finished. Some people, yes, they're tried with illness, for example, until they die. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the Day of Judgment will not ask them, "Why did you die ill?" But He will ask them, "Why did you die as non-Muslim?" Non-Muslim doesn't mean just follower of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam since the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. No, before the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, they were called Muslims as well as non-Muslims. Anyone that followed Tawheed, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, followed the Prophets before the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, they were called Muslims as well. Because Islam is total submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and following the teachings of His Prophets. Of course, after the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, it's a different story altogether. At the time of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, there was this young man called Umayr ibn Saad. Now, Umayr ibn Saad lived as an orphan because his father died while he was still young. And he was brought up by his mother. They were left very, very poor. From the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that the mother of Umayr remarried again. And she married this man called Al-Julas ibn Suwayd, from the people of Al-Ansar, from Al-Aws specifically. Al-Aws and Khazraj are the two tribes that formed Al-Ansar in the time of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So Al-Julas ibn Suwayd, he was amongst the people of Al-Aws. That's not really important at this stage. What's important is that he's married the mother of Umayr ibn Saad, and he was very, very rich, this man. Al-Julas was very rich. And he looked after Umayr, and he treated him like his son, and he loved him so much. In return, Umayr also loved Al-Julas ibn Suwayd, and he looked at him as like a father figure. Umayr radiallahu anhu used to be so keen about Salat with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and so keen about attending the gatherings of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Sometimes he would go with his stepfather, sometimes he would go by himself. But for his mother, the most loved moment is to see the two of them being together, seeing Umayr, her son, and her husband Al-Julas being together. They lived in harmony and in love with one another. In the ninth year of the Hijrah of the Prophet ﷺ, the Prophet ﷺ ordered the Muslims to prepare themselves and get ready for the conquest of Tabuk. Most of us know about the Ghazwa of Tabuk. It happened in the ninth year of the Hijrah of the Prophet ﷺ. The reason the Prophet ﷺ told them to get ready is because the distance is so long between Medina and Tabuk. It's over 600 kilometers. And it would take probably about 10 to 15 days for them to reach Tabuk. So they had to prepare well. But knowing the Sahaba and the life that they lived, they didn't have much wealth, except few. People like Uthman, like Abdul Rahman ibn Awf, radiallahu anhu. And when they were preparing, these people like Uthman, radiallahu anhu, and Abdul Rahman ibn Awf, they came forward to the Prophet ﷺ, and they gave so much fi sabilillah to help the army that's going to Tabuk. Also, other Sahaba did the same, as well as the women. The women, they brought their jewelry, whatever they had, and they presented it before the Prophet ﷺ. Now, the young Umayr is watching, and he could see all of this happening in front of him. But what was bothering Umayr is that his stepfather, Al-Julas, who is very rich, hasn't come forward to the Prophet ﷺ and given some of his wealth. But out of respect, he didn't go directly and say to Al-Julas, why didn't you give? He went and he sat down with Al-Julas and he started telling him about the sacrifice of the Sahaba and how they're giving everything fi sabilillah, hoping that that will move him and he will go forward and do the same. But Al-Julas looked at Umayr and he made this statement, which was very, very, very shocking. Shocking to Umayr, because he never expected such a thing from Al-Julas. He said, Ya Umayr, he said, listen, Umayr, إن كان محمد صادقا فنحن شر من الحمير. He said, and I'm translating word for word almost, then I'll give the explanation inshallah. He said, if Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was truthful, was saying the truth, then we are worse than donkeys. Meaning that we are stupid, silly, to listen to such claims from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is not the man that Umayr is used to. So he was shocked, and rightly so. The young Umayr, he had to make a decision straight away. On one hand, this is the person that looked after him all his life and showered him with wealth and mercy and everything. On the other hand, there's Allah and His Messenger. So Umayr had to make a decision. And it had to be the right decision. He looked at Al-Julas and he said, oh Al-Julas, you've been to me the most loved person after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You are like a father to me. But you made such a big statement, such a wrong statement. And I'm going to report it to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Because if I don't, I'm going to be betraying Allah and His Messenger. It's not an easy test. And for anyone to make a decision at that time, you might think it's straightforward, but it is not. And he said to Julas, so prepare yourself for the question. And he made his way to the Masjid of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam sitting down with his companions. Umayr came and told him exactly what happened. But Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam he's not going to just listen to Umayr. He has to listen to the other side of the story before making judgment. And that's what we should do really all the time. Even like with our kids, one of our kids comes and says that such and such hit me, don't take his side of the story. Listen to the other side. With you, if you're in position of authority at work, sometimes people might come to you and say, such and such done this. Can't listen. I mean, listen, but don't take their words for it. Listen to the other side of the story. Because most of the time, what we tend to do, is when we report story, we give what benefits us, what serves us. We don't consider the other side. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, out of justice, he sent out for Julas to come back, to come to him. So Julas came. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Ma ma'alatun sami'tuha anka ya sami'tuha min Umayr." I heard a statement that you made, and Umayr reported it. And he told him exactly what Umayr said. And Julas looked at Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and he said, "Kadhaba ya Rasulullah." He's lying. Umayr is lying. I never said such a thing. And if you want, we can give an oath before you, Ya Rasulullah. I swear by Allah that I didn't say, and he swears by Allah that I said. And while this he's talking, the Sahaba are looking at Umayr. His face become red. His face become red and he's crying. Tears are coming out of his. Because people normally, they would believe the older person. They're going to say, well, he's a young person who doesn't know what he's doing, whatever. But the Sahaba were divided in this. Some of them, they said, after he looked after him, and this is also by the Munafiqeen main. After he looked after him and he brought him up, this is what he is doing. This is how he pays him back. And the others, they said, no, Umayr has been brought up in a house and in the Masjid of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And you can see the truth in his face. He will not say, he will not lie. And while they're talking, they looked at the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was quiet. And they could see signs of revelation. Al-Wahi, descending of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam at that time. So they all stopped. And they didn't say a word, waiting for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to speak. At that time, Umayr is raising his hands to Allah and asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to show the truth. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala responds to Umayr because he's being truthful. Prophet reads, وَلَقَدْ قَالُوا كَلِمَةَ الْكُفْرِ وَكَفَرُوا بَعْدَ إِسْلَامِهِمْ وَهَمُّوا بِمَا لَمْ يَنَالُوا فَإِنْ يَتُوبُوا يَكُ خَيْرًا لَهُمْ وَإِنْ يَتَوَلَّوا يُعَذِّبْهُمُ اللَّهُ عَذَابًا أَلِيمًا فِي الدُّنْيَا وَالْآخِرَةِ وَمَا لَهُمْ فِي الْأَرْضِ مِنْ وَلِيٍّ وَلَا نَصِيرٍ. Indeed, they said, statement of kufr, of disbelief. وَكَفَرُوا بَعْدَ إِسْلَامِهِمْ. And they disbelieved after they accepted Islam. فإن يتوبوا يكون خيرا لهم. If they repent, then that would be better for them. وإن يتولوا, if they turn away, يعذبهم الله عذابا أليما. Allah سبحانه وتعالى will give them severe punishment in this dunya and in the hereafter. At that time, at that stage, Al-Julas said, بَلْ أَتُوبُ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ بَلْ أَتُوبُ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ I will repent, Al-Julas. I will repent, O Messenger of Allah. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept my repentance. Ask Allah to accept my repentance. That shows us, subhanAllah, it shows us the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. After all of this, what he insulted the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, after accepting ridda, he turned away from Islam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, out of his mercy, he says, فَإِنْ يَتُوبُ يَكُ خَيْرًا لَهُ. Amazing. We should think about this, we should reflect about this. At any time, you make a mistake, you commit a sin, remember this statement, فَإِنْ يَتُوبُ يَكُ خَيْرًا لَهُ. No matter how many times you make mistakes, فَإِنْ يَتُوبُ يَكُ خَيْرًا لَهُ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, يَتُوبُ is a mudari. It's an ongoing process. Every time you make mistakes, you make still, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepts. With one condition, be sincere to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And never think that you're gonna make tawbah and go back to whatever you've done. No. When you make tawbah, think that you're gonna make tawbah without going back to that sin. And you might go back to that sin, but your intention was never to go back to that sin. If you do go back to that sin, tawbah again. Prophet said, وَلَنْ يَمَلَّ اللَّهُ حَتَّى تَمَلَّ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will never have enough of making you tawbah. He will never subhanahu wa ta'ala give up on you. As long as you make tawbah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will accept your repentance. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepted the repentance of Al-Julas. And his Islam became even better after this incident. And whenever Umayr was mentioned in front of Al-Julas, he said, Jazakallah khairan anni anqadhani min an-nar. May Allah reward him, Umayr, because he saved me from the hellfire. That's how Al-Julas also approached this tawbah. أقول قولي هذا أستغفر الله لي ولكم فاستغفروا إنه هو الغفور الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه. As I said, the hardest trial that can happen to a person is that which touches his deen. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, from his hikmah, he gave us the solution. And one also might ask, if we face any trials or tribulations, what is the best approach? The approach is in the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This book that we cut ties with. We read it from Ramadan to Ramadan, and we read it if someone dies, and we read it if we fall ill. No, this book is a guideline for us. And it tells us the solutions to our problems, our trials that we face. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, in Surah Al-Baqarah, وَاسْتَعِينُوا بِالصَّبْرِ وَالصَّلَاةِ. Seek help with sabr and with salah. Very simple statement. You have to have sabr at the time of bala, whether it's in your health, wealth, whatever, you have to have sabr. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also says, وَبَشِّرِ الصَّابِرِينَ. Give glad tidings to those who are patient, الصَّابِرِينَ. And also, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala instructed us to seek help with salat. And salat here doesn't mean the 5 daily prayers only. It does include the 5 daily prayers, but all types of ibadah. Dua is considered as salat. Dua is considered as salat as well. If you seek help from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with dua, you are following this statement, وَبَشِّرِ الصَّابِرِينَ. وَاسْتَعِينُوا بِالصَّبْرِ وَالصَّلَاةِ. Seek help with sabr and with salat. Also, turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through his book by finding out about the meanings of the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this book. Read this book as much as possible. Wallahi, there is so much barakah in this book. Wallahi, there is so much solutions in this book. Wallahi, there is so much shifa in this book. Wallahi, there is so much tranquility that you gain from this book. We claim that we are on Islam, we are on Sunnah, some of us say we are Salafi, some of us say we are this, we are that. You know, titles, they won't help. They won't help you. In this dunya or in the hereafter, they won't help you. What helps you is your deen. You claim you're Sunni or whatever, you've got Islam, you don't read the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What Islam is that? What kind of Islam is that? You don't read the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Some people, wallahi, with beards and stuff like that, and you ask them, how many times have you read Quran in your life? How many times have you finished the Quran in your life? And they say, not once. I've not managed to finish it yet. What kind of Islam are we following? We want solutions to our problem. Wallahi, the solution is in the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Also, to seek knowledge is really important. Because knowledge is a light. Al-ilmu nur. And the light, you need it when you go into darkness. And if you don't have that light, you've got nothing to help you find your way out. So seeking knowledge is really important as well. And there are so many things, so many statements in the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the stories, if you read just the story of Yusuf alayhi salam, it will teach you how to deal with every trial. Just read the story of Yusuf alayhi salam in the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It will help you. It will teach you how to get over all the trials that you face. What Yusuf faced, hardly anyone faced except the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. As I said, seeking knowledge starts with the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Also read about the life of the Sahaba. Okay, some people might say, look, those are prophets. They are supported by wahi, by revelation, and so on. What about the Sahaba? Read the life of the Sahaba, and you see, you learn so much, so many things in the life of the Sahaba. The bottom line is seek knowledge from its authentic sources, not from wherever, I mean from the WhatsApp and from social media and stuff like that. No, from its authentic sources. And that will help you get over your trials and your tribulations. Also make the effort. You have to make the effort. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed to Maryam. To Maryam is wa husdi ilayki bijid'in nakhlati. To sa'id alayki rutaban janiyya. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala instructed Maryam to move the palm tree and it will drop dates on her so that she can eat those dates. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala could have just ordered the dates to fall, but he wants her to take action. The same for us. We have to take action. You're not praying Salat al-Fajr. You have to take action. You have to set up your alarm clock and say, from tomorrow inshallah, I'm going to try and wake up for Salat al-Fajr. Your child is not praying. You have to take action. Not just make dua. Making dua is really important. But you have to take action. teach them that Salat al-Fajr is just the same as the other salawat. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not order us to pray four times a day. He ordered us five times a day. And it starts with Salat al-Fajr. It's really important. Come to Salat al-Fajr in so many messages, you find six, seven people. And when it comes to giving, for example, fi sabilillah, you find some people coming really forward. That is good. But what's more important is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made fard on you. And that starts with Salat al-Fajr. I don't want to take any longer because people have to go to work. Ibadallah, inna Allah amarakum bi amrin bada'a fihi bi nafsihi wa thanna bi malaikati qudsihi wa hadda 'alayhi mu'minina min 'ibadihi jinnihi wa insihi. فقالت سبحانه وتعالى إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين وأذل الشرك والمشركين واحم حوزة الدين اللهم انصر عبادك المجاهدين الذين يجاهدون في سبيلك في كل مكان اللهم أيهم بنصرك اللهم ارض على قلوبهم اللهم سدد رميهم اللهم انصرهم على عدوك وعدوهم اللهم كل إخواننا المستضعفين في سوريا وفي فلسطين وفي كل مكان عباد الله إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون ولذكر الله أكبر والله يعلم ما تصنعون أقيم الصلاة.
الله أكبر الله أكبر أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن محمدا رسول الله حي الصلاة حي الفلاة ورضاهم الصلاة ورضاهم الصلاة الله أكبر الله أكبر لا إله إلا الله.
استووا مستقيم واعتدل. استووا. الله الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. آمين. ألم تر كيف فعل ربك بأصحاب الفيل ألم يجعل كيدهم في تضليل وأرسل عليهم طيرا أبابيل ترويهم بحجارة من سجيل فاجعلهم كعصف مأكول. الله سمع الله لمن حمده. الله الله نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. السلام عليكم. Couple of announcements tonight. Inshallah, there'll be no lectures between live and Isha. Instead, we're having our tea and coffee session, monthly session, inshallah. So everyone is welcome, inshallah. Also tomorrow, inshallah, the Sheikh Ahmed Khafaji will continue with the lessons about the Quran, the Makharij and the Sifat al-Kawf. That's between 4 and 7. And next week, inshallah, in that Tuesday and Wednesday, we have any Sheikhs coming from Saudi Arabia, inshallah. As well as Sheikh Al-Hayda. The Qali, famous Qali, he's going to need Salat Qali here and probably Salat Isha as well, but definitely Salat Qali, inshallah. And there'll be lectures from 6 to 10, inshallah, for 2 days, Tuesday and Wednesday, inshallah. And everyone is welcome, it's free, so please make the most of it, inshallah, and come be with you, inshallah, with you, Sheikh.